Good. So this, the first talk of today is about architectural patterns and other peculiarities of developing GUIs. It's going to include, well, not surprisingly, the contents are going to be architectural patterns. We will go through what they are, and a few of them. Event-driven programming, which is the a fundamental thing in when developing GUIs. And also we will talk about multithreading and multiprocessing, which has a slightly, well, I think that it has a different meaning when we talk about GUIs than we talk about the research software, or at least understood in a different way. So according to Wikipedia, I copied this definition from there, which in turn was taken from a textbook. Architectural pattern is a general reusable solution to a commonly occurring problem in software architecture within a given context. In this case, the context that we are talking about is GUIs, graphical user interfaces. Beyond this abstract definition, in practice, what this means is that you organize your application in abstractions, in roles, different roles, regardless of whether we are talking about code, whether we are talking about data, whether we are talking about imperative language programming, declarative language programming. The important thing is what role that part of the software is doing, and you organize your code according to that. These solutions, architectural patterns, are not some random idea that someone has created. They are actual thoughts, very well thought solutions to problems that have been appearing in software engineering along many years, over decades. So they do solve problems. You will notice that sometimes you try to use a particular architectural pattern and your code looks weird. That's probably because either you are not using the correct pattern and you should choose a different one that adapts better to what you are trying to do, or you are using the correct pattern but you are applying it wrong. But architectural patterns do work and do help you. So it's good to think on your code, on your software, in terms of how it can be used or how you can exploit an architectural pattern. Architectural patterns promote modularity and reusability. So you will notice this later on when I show an example in the second lecture of today, that you can have the same part of the software reuse in different software. And I also mentioned yesterday, I mentioned this tool I created to get data from the laboratory equipment. I use the same tool, the same backend later on fieldwork, and the same backend on an outreach activity. The thing that was changing was the front end. That was possible simply because I had used some, without knowing, because I didn't know about architectural patterns back then, I had used an architectural pattern to separate the concerns between front end and the back end. This is something that it's, well, the bread and butter on when we talk about web applications. They kind of come with this kind of separation automatically, but it is not that often for desktop applications, and definitely not that often found on richer software. So it's good to think about that. Having an architectural pattern, and especially having this modularity and separation of concerns, helps a lot testing your code. Everything is good news if you are able to pick the correct one, which is the last point. There are a lot of patterns. They are very abstract, but the definition of the patterns is very abstract. So sometimes it's very confusing to decide whether I am using the correct pattern or whether I should use a different one, or actually what the pattern is actually trying to solve, what's the problem that it's trying to solve. This is a very, well, it's on purpose, because patterns are supposed to be abstract and then have a really different realization in different languages or different contexts. But it also makes hard for people to start using it. And we will see some examples on this problem. So we are going to be, well, first of all, what patterns do you know? Do you know any architectural pattern without entering into more details? Please speak up. Or does it make sense at all? So architectural patterns, yeah, there's someone in the chat. What do we have here? No, the answer is no. Good, that's absolutely fine. normally you don't know anything about architectural patterns unless someone mentioned them or explained them to you. This is sort of thing that you don't go there unless someone has, it's like a, this kind of bars or pubs where, the, where you don't go unless someone has invited you to go there. Okay, yeah, that's absolutely fine. And so we will see, there are tons of architectural patterns. If you Google architectural pattern, you will have hundreds of them, well, not hundreds, but tens of them, definitely, applied to different contexts, different problems. We're going to see three of them. One, the layer pattern is not specific for GUIs. It is used in many other contexts of software engineering. The model view controller is the first and most widely used and most misunderstood pattern, I think. Model view presenter is an evolution of the model view controller. So we will see these three of them. Hopefully I will try to shed some light into how they work and what they are, but bear with me that it is a rather complex concept, problem. So the layer pattern applied in particular to GUI applications. It's something that comes very naturally when you write code, which is to split the code into different layers, with each layer calling the next layer. In GUI applications, and each layer only communicates with the next one. In GUIs, you will have a presentation layer that contains the GUI design and the code to handle the interaction between the different components. An application layer that is an abstraction layer for the business layer. Let's say that it's a layer that puts together the functionality that it is described and implemented in the business layer. The business layer is the one that does the hard work, the one that has the it's solving some particular model or a mathematical model, or it's doing some heavy duty calculations, that sort of thing. That's done in the business layer. The persistent layer is again an interface layer between the business layer and the database layer. The database does not necessarily to be an actual database in the traditional sense. It could be files with data without any formal database structure, universal constants, or anything that is something on disk or in the cloud that the business layer requires to do its job, and that is not code. So the database are just numbers or list of strings or it could be a text or something like that. So it's not code. The database is not code. Each of these layers talk to each other and pass the information up or down depending on what they are doing. And as I said, it's a pattern very easy to implement. It's easy to implement because it comes very naturally when you write code to separate things into this type of structures. Sometimes one of these layers is missing, or sometimes you find two of these layers merged together, but in general they can be distinguished some more or less. Command line application, you can imagine this is for a GUI application. A command line application is very similar. You just miss the presentation layer. The end of the story is the application layer that puts together several of the functionality of the business layer and offer a non-graphical interface to the user to use that functionality. A framework, according to what we discussed yesterday, will be similar, but without the application layer, just the business layer down. It contains data in addition to the code and the functionality included in the business layer. And the libraries, following the same description as yesterday, will be just the business layer. So they don't have data, they don't have an application layer, they are just tools that you can use in your code. So this is a useful, simple way of organizing your code. But it is not specific for GUIs. GUIs is just the upper layer of it. Specific for GUIs is a famous or infamous model view controller. And I added this quote here from this blog, Coding Horror, because it kind of reflects what I was thinking when I was learning about the model view controller. A problem with the MVC is that it's so generic, it can apply to almost any architecture that isn't a total spaghetti code. This makes new programmers feel stupid, since they will gain understanding of a particular flavor of the MVC and then run into a different flavor and think to themselves, I guess I don't understand MVC after all. Eventually, they realize that the term MVC is so broadly applied to that it doesn't convey much information unless qualified with a particular flavor. Smalltalk MVC, Cocoa MVC, Rails MVC. So the takeaway message of this one is that you will Google MVC and you will find very different descriptions of what it is, what model, view, and controller means, what each of those parts is doing or what it's supposed to do, and especially how those are implemented in a particular programming language or in a particular framework. Do not despair. Overall, they are about more or less the same thing. It's just that very often different programming languages, they're very different toolkits, impose some restrictions on how this type of architecture can be realized. But I felt very identified with this comment, so I thought that it was good to put it here so you don't feel stupid. That's what it is normal. I did it so too. So so what's model view controller? The model view controller is has this sort of architecture. It again has several components similar to the layer architecture, but in this case there's more emphasis on the part related to the user. So we have the view that defines the display, and that's all it does. So it's a passive structure. Typically, it could be even some kind of using some, it could be done some using some declarative programming language. It just says, okay, here's a button, here is a table, here's a drop-down menu, here it's arranged, this is arranged this way, this is this color, this is this color. That's the view, that's all it does. Whenever the user interacts with this view, the view sends that information, that event, to the controller. The controller is the one that is running the event loop and has the control logic. And based on what's the interaction that the view has sent, it will do different things. It could be that it implies updating the view with some things, selecting something from a drop-down list, should open a new window or something like that. So it will be updating the view, but it could be that it means that the software has to run some calculation in the background. In that case, the controller will communicate with the model, which is the last part of the problem. The model defines the data structures, database if you want, all the business logic, and also the application layer. So it will do all the heavy work and communicate with the underlying layer. The model doesn't communicate back any information. This is in principle, and you will see several implementations of this one, but in principle, in one of the most extended implementations, I think, of the MVC, the model just changes the state of some data. And that data is observed by the view and sometimes also the controller. So those two, the view and the controller, are seeing whether this has been a change in the model or not, in the data of the model or not. And based on what they observe, they respond. They update a plot with new information if they observe there has been new information, or open some other view if they observe that there has been some flag set in the data structure. But there is not really any direct communication, or there shouldn't be a direct communication between the model and the other two. This is called a weak relationship between the view, the controller, and the model down there. This is useful to separate concerns, but sometimes it's very restrictive. Sometimes you will want the model to be able to directly update the view or directly tell the controller to do something else. That's not how the MVC works, and it has been one of the criticisms of it, and the reason that there has been many other derived models related to this one, very similar in many ways, but different and trying to solve this problem. If we think on again on frameworks, libraries, command line applications, and GUIs, we could try to think. It's not that, but you could think on the model as similar to a command line application. It doesn't need to be a command line application. It can be a code in a library, but the relationship between the model and the other two is similar to what we will have. The model should be largely independent or completely independent, should be able to run the problem on its own, and the view and the controller are some sort of accessors to that functionality that are external to the model. So based on the model view controller, there were refinements over the years, trying to solve some of the issues it had or the restrictions it imposed. And one of the most common ones is called the model view presenter. All of these are called model view something, or model view view something, or model view something, or that sort of thing. So they are not the original. Again, it's a layered architecture in some ways. We still have the view, we still have the model, but instead of a controller, we have now what is called the presenter. The presenter is something that has part of the controller. So it contains control logic, but it steals some information, some of the responsibilities that before were part of the model. So the application model, now it's part of the presenter. And typically there will be one presenter per view. So the view and the presenter are strongly coupled. The model and the presenter are also strongly coupled. They can talk to each other directly, but the model has no idea of the view, and the view has no idea of the model. The presenter always asks, I act as a middle layer. Sometimes there is even an extra layer called the view interface that decouples a little bit the presenter and the view. So the view can be implemented with any toolkit. The presenter doesn't know anything about that toolkit because the one that buffers that communication is the view interface. This is more flexible than the model view controller because there's a stronger coupling between the different layers. And in my experience, developing GUIs, it's much easier to implement. So you will have a model that can be a library, a Python package somewhere else. You will have a presenter that contains some apps that puts together the functionality of the model, and that also has some links to the view, to some information on how to display or how to update things in the view. And then the view that has a very similar functionality as in the case before. It contains the display itself, the layout of things, the colors of things. And it, in the case of the model view presenter, it often contains a functionality that only relates to a changing the state of the view. So if, for example, moving the scroll you have a text widget with some text there, you move a scroll to go down. That scrolling, in the case of the model view controller, the fact that the text should move, that information, that control should be in the controller. In the model view presenter, that information is not in the controller, it's not in the presenter, it's in the view because it's a GUI only event. It has nothing to do with the model, it has nothing to do with the presenter. It's just about how the view itself manipulates itself. Thinking again on the different types of software we have been talking about, in this case, the model will be similar to the framework. It needs an application layer to be usable, and that application layer in this case is part of the presenter. In a full software, GUI application will typically have several presenters, each of them linked with several views, but the model will be the same in all cases. So you can imagine different presenters views, different presenter views all pointing to the same model, doing different things. And each of the presenters will contain the logic and the application model that is relevant exclusively to talk with their corresponding view. They will not have information on how to control or how to manipulate the other view. if you have, can imagine a software with different windows or different panels, that will be the case. So that's all about the model, the architectural patterns. You might think that, well, that's all that it is. Well, that's all that it is, and that's more than enough. Putting this into practice in real life is incredibly hard for desktop applications. As I said, for web applications, this comes quite natural. But for desktop applications, the way the GUI toolkits are organized, or and also the way the developers are used to think about developing software for desktop, makes adopting this type of GUI specific structures, the MVP and MVC, very, very difficult. Once you get used to it, you will do it better and faster. But to start with, it takes time and a lot of thought on how to organize your code, how to organize the information, what sort of intermediate layers you will need to add to your code to make it usable. The whole point, as we remember from the beginning of this talk, is to have the software in such a way that it's modular, where you have different roles defined, or you can reuse different parts of the code for other things. For example, one interesting thing, in this case, you have the model that you can reuse with different presenters and different views. In the case of the model view controller, you have the model, but that model also defines the application layer. And that's a bit weird, because that application layer will contain information that will not be, it's an application layer, so it's something to perform a particular task, but that application layer will be available for a view and a controller that do not want to use that particular layer, that particular application layer, because it's about doing something else. In this case, no. In the case of MVP, the application layer, that which is in the presenter, concerns only and exclusively the things that the view relates to. So there is more separation. There is no code in the front that shouldn't be there. So this is not that much, but it is more than enough to start with. This is not a good practice about presenting, but I'm going to go back here to the model view controller. This observe for changes that the view that links the view and the model is often done with another architectural pattern called the observer pattern. It's a very, very useful pattern in general, has nothing to do with GUIs in particular, that allows a part of your code to check for changes in another part of the code without this part of the code being aware at all that it's been observed by someone else. And it is used very often. That one is very easy to implement in different computer languages, and you can find, if you Google observer pattern for Python, you will have several pages explaining how this is done, and it is basic to do and basic to integrate. So yeah, you have actually four patterns to learn. Layer pattern, model view controller, model view presenter, and observer pattern. So here about architectural patterns. Now there's another aspect of GUIs that it's very important and that people doesn't realize of its importance and how it changes everything really, which is event-driven programming. Again, taking from Wikipedia, it's a programming paradigm in which the flow of the program is determined by events, such as user interactions, sensor outputs, a message passing from one place to another. This is very different to what a normal research software does, which tend to be linear. You start the software, it calls a function, calls another function, creates some object. There might be loops there doing some stuff. There might be multiple processes going in parallel. At the end, all of these processes collapse to one single process. Then there's some other manipulation, and then the program ends, and there's some output produced. It's linear. It has a beginning. It has an end. in event-driven programming, there is no beginning and not end. You can start the program, you will end the program, but in the middle, there is not a linear sequence of activities. Everything is happening into a loop, very nicely called the event loop. What I'm showing here is the event loop for a single thread application. We will talk about multiple threading later on. So you have a program that you start, and then there is a loop, literally a loop in the traditional sense of programming languages. While not finishing, keep doing the loop. This event loop will be listening for events that will happen in the application, and based on what those events are, it will trigger some actions, some callbacks. These callbacks will be executed, and then the flow of the program will go back to the loop. This is single thread, so when the callback is being executed, the event is not running. There's nothing else going on. I have included here a particular example for Python using the Qt libraries, PySide. So we have a function that says hello and that prints a button click hello in the terminal. So nothing fancy. We have a button that have a text that says click me. And here is where the magic happens. We have the button, and we associate, link that button, connect that button to this function, to the function that we defined here. So we are saying that when the user click this button, there should be the function say hello should be executed. This is an event. The event is the user clicking the button. The effect of that event, the result of that event is that that function should be executed. This will be a user driven event, so the user has to interact with the GUI for something to happen. But there are all kinds of events. Some here I have put a few examples. So it could be scheduled events like the one on the left every 30 minutes. Check that they say that if there are updates available for the application. So the event is that 30 minutes have passed. That triggers the event, and the callback will be checking the updates. This will be this similar to the previous one. The user pushes a button, and then something happens that is saved. This will be a GUI only event, so it is triggered by the user. The user drags a scroll bar, but the callback is not defined typically by the user. It is something that the GUI toolkit will take care of. When you drag a scroll bar, some widgets will need to be redrawn, but you don't define how those are how that is done. That is taken care of by the GUI toolkit. Another kind of event, this has been something going on in the background, a file being downloaded. When that is completed, that's the event, finishing that download, then something happens, there's a pop-up notifying the user that the file has been downloaded. And this is all that it is. The event loop keeps listening for events and executing the corresponding callbacks. Now, in single thread, always in general, callbacks are stateful functions. So they might accept inputs, but they do not return anything. After pushing a button, a function will be executed, but there is nothing coming back to the main loop, to the events loop from that function. They change the state of something, the state of the application. It can be changing some part of the GUI. It can be updating a file on disk. It can be sending something over the internet. That's the result of the event always. It's always a change of the state of the application. This makes testing way more complex. If you are coming from Java, you might be used to these sort of things. But if you're coming from other more functional programming languages, this is an absolute pain. You have a need to set up the environment for the function, because since you are updating the state, you have to define that state and then observe that the state has changed rather than providing an input and an output of your function and see if the output is the expected one. And very often, this sort of event-driven programming requires mocking techniques for things that we will see in the last lesson today. And the other thing that, since we are talking about single-thread programming, the executing callbacks blocks the loop. Once, while that callback is being action, while it is being executed, nothing else is happening in the GUI until the callback returns. That means that the GUI will be irresponsive. The user will have, if you are not providing any sort of feedback, the user will have no idea what's going on. It might keep clicking to see if something can be done. In Windows, there is a typical, if it's a long running callback at the top of the window in Windows, it often says, application not responding, and sometimes you get a pop-up window saying the application is not responding. Do you want to close it? Then, no, don't close it. It's running a very complex operation, please. Event-driven programming comes with, in single-thread case, it comes with these issues. The event loop is the core of the GUI. It's all the core of the GUI in desktop applications, in web applications, and in mobile applications. Every time that there is a GUI, there is an event loop. It can be called in a different way, main loop sometimes, but it's always the same thing. So having this event loop comes with some issues that make testing more complex, overall assessing the state of the application more complex. And if we are working with single thread, it also has issues related to the responsivity of the application for the user. And this brings us to the last part of this first lecture, which is multithreading and multiprocessing. I'm not going to read these two definitions. They are coming from Wikipedia and from that blog there, Floyd Hub, really good article. Read it because it's very revealing. This picture here, I've taken it from that blog to show what's the difference between a program, a process and a thread. Essentially, a process is one instance of the application, and you might have your application running. It has one single process, and that's all it is. That will be, for example, the case that it shows there for Spotify. And within this process, you might have several threads that running, that share that the same space of memory, a memory space, that share the same variables, the same objects, and that can even, in some cases, communicate with each other. They are executed in parallel, the threads, but they will use the same processor or the same resources than the parent process. It's not they are not using something else. You might have another case, which is the one similar to a browser. You will have a parent process that will be the browser UI, and then each of the tabs will have also different processes. Within each process, you will have threads the same way as before. But the threads don't really communicate much with each other, especially the child processes. One in a browser, a tab doesn't talk to the other tab. They are kind of independent things. Each process is typically is executed in its own processor, typically, its own memory space. So communication between processes is not typically something done in normal GUI applications. As I said before, within each of the process, you might have multiple threads. This is a slightly different picture as what multiprocessing or multithreading means in HPC. When you use this sort of things in high-performance computing, you want to increase the performance of your application, have the results faster, or process many files simultaneously. It's all about performance. It's about performance, but it is not really about super performance, high performance computing. It's not about doing many very heavy calculations at the same time. It's about responsivity of the GUI for the user. You don't want the GUI to get stuck doing things in the background without the responding to the user input. So multiprocessing and multithreading are very common are the norm in GUI applications, and it's something that you should consider including in your GUIs for research software. Not so much because it's a performance thing, but because of responsivity for the user. This is a screenshot from the activity monitor of my computer, of my laptop, while I was preparing these slides. You can see that multithreading is common in all GUI applications. PyCharm, which is the editor I use for writing Python applications, has 53 threads. My PowerPoint has it, my Chrome has it, Finder, Safari, every application, every GUI application is running typically many, many threads. One thread might be checking for updates of the application from time to time. Another thread might be the spell checker. Another might be dealing with the auto-completion feature when you're writing code, suggesting what you are going to write, or completing the closing bracket, or comparing what you are writing with the previous version of the file on disk, using some sort of git diff, things like that. All these things are running in the background. They provide extra functionality. They don't block the event loop, so the application keeps running without any issue of performance. Multithreading are typically good for anything related with input-output and providing response to the user and a small task running in the background. When we have in CPU-intensive activities or memory independent tasks, it is more often to use multiprocessing. Instead of creating a thread to deal with that activity, you create a separate process. Again, using multiple processes is very common in GUI applications. This is an example, again, a screenshot of my computer of Safari with several processes going on at the same time. You can see that each of the tabs that I had open at that time were a different process, but there are also other processes rather going on that are related with services that Safari needs for running. So they are not always processes that the user should be aware of or that are needed directly by the user. But it could be something that the application needs. If you have many processes, in the end, the performance of the computer will be hindered, of course. But in modern computers with several cores, you can have running many processes without too much performance loss. The processor will take care of dealing with that. These processes will not talk to each other typically. And they're independent, and they could be independent CPU intensive tasks. So when to use multiprocessing or multithreading in research software? Both should be used as often as needed. So take them as something that you must use rather than something that you can use, because it is a GUI application, and any GUI application should be responsive to the user. So if you have to run some complex calculation in the background, some modeling, some heavy calculation, run that as a separate project, as a separate process. If you have to open another window of the program to do something else, because the program can have several different activities that doesn't need to be related to each other, then you can run that as another process. And they will be kind of independent program process, the independent activities. But if you have to download something from the internet, the user clicks a button and needs to download something from the internet, or if it is a process that is running in the background to update some of the underlying data, that's a thread. That's something that can be run as a thread. If you are saving data, this is a very common autosave features of many programs. That's a thread. It's not a different process, it's a thread. if you need to communicate with the lab equipment, you are running a program that have to get data from a machine as it is measuring your samples. That again, that communication it's a thread. Communication between the computer and the machine, and then the thread returns the information from that machine. But you should get used to use these threads and these processes as a normal thing in your application. So it's something that you will need to learn. It's one of these skills that it's recommended that you will need to include in your GUI applications. It's not, it's optional, but if you want to make a good quality GUI, even if it is for yourself, you will need to include that. And in addition to using threads and processes, you need to inform the user that it's something going on. That's again something that we are very used to when we work with any GUI application. You have progress bars showing what, I mean, sometimes they don't show a very accurate measure of what's the progress of the activity is, but they show some progress of what's going on. So the users know, okay, well, there's some, this file is being uploaded, and this is the progress of that activity. It might be that that's a blocking process and the user shouldn't be allowed to interact with the application until that is done. That's fine, but inform the user of that fact so they are not thinking what's going on. But it might be that it's something that is running in the background, like when you download a file from the internet, you can see in the browser sometimes this progress bar saying, okay, this is the status of the download of the file. Inform the user that that's happening. Include that sort of widget in your GUI showing that progress. Or status traffic lights, if there is a communication with a lab equipment, for example, what's the status of that communication? Is it live? Has it failed for some reason? That can be, and again, a process that is checking from time to time how is that communication going on, and being red or yellow or green depending on the status of that communication. In any case, it's all about informing the user of what's going on in your application, and keep the application responsive and fluid for the user to use. So, to conclude this first lesson. Architectural patterns help you to organize your code. So they help you organize two applications, not just the code, actually, the whole application. Making the components reusable and modular. The important thing is that there are many architectural patterns. They are abstract concepts, so very easy to apply them wrong or to be confused on how to use them or to use the wrong one, simply. So very often you will need to revise if you think that your code it's not looking right or it's being overly complicated when you try to apply a particular pattern. You might need to rethink what are you applying or how you're applying it, because it might be that you need to change your strategy. GUIs use an event loop, and that requires using event-driven programming. Typical research software applications do not use this sort of cyclic flow of information, and that means that programmers, developers that come from that background will need to get used to working with event-driven programming and what the challenges that sort of programming brings to the table. We will discuss a little bit more about this in the part about testing, because this is very much related with the testing. And finally, GUIs, GUI applications, all desktop applications, all web applications, all mobile applications, we use multithreading for all sorts of activities, multithreading and multiprocessing. For small tasks running in the background, for big tasks that take a long time to do, they do it all the time. So if you enter into the world of coding GUIs for your research software, you must get used to use them. To learn how to use them, to make the software more fluid, to get responsive, to offer the user a better performance, and depending on what you are doing, you might get better performance overall in your software, regardless of whether the user is being more satisfied with the result. That's all from this talk. This is the, let's say, the theory, the abstract part of today. The next talk after the break and the later talk about testing is more about, okay, well, this is great, but doesn't tell me anything. How do I use this? How do I apply this sort of concept in real world examples? We will do that later. So you might have doubts now, but those might be answered. I will try to answer them now, but those might be better answered later when we see specific examples and what the specific code going on. So that's all for now for this first session. Do you have any question?
Yes, I have one question.
Yeah, go ahead.
I don't know if you mentioned, but what will be the main constraints of layer architecture?
The main constraint is that very often you don't need, or for many of the things that the software is doing, you don't need all the layers. So You might find that sometimes, since you are communicating the first layer with the bottom layer, or the middle layer with the bottom layer with going in between, those are applications. They are called, they have a specific name. Let's see if I can find it. That CRUD application. So it comes from create, read, update, delete. And I'm going to paste this into the chat. These sort of applications very often skip layers, and that's not good, because if you have a layer, you have to go from layer to layer. You cannot officially, if you really implement that pattern, you cannot jump from one layer to another, jumping over the middle layers. That means that you are going to need to put a lot of useless code in the middle layers that simply relay information from one place to another. That's useless code. That's a source of errors, a source of problems that is really not really the point. That's not the point of architectural patterns.
Okay.
Patterns are meant to be useful. So in those cases, applying the layer architecture is just not the correct choice.
Okay, thank you.
Any more question? Nothing? Okay, so if you don't have any other question, or at least if you think that the questions that you have might be solved by this is not what I wanted to show you now. If you think that I didn't know this could be. If you don't think that you have any more questions now, sorry, then we will have a break now until 10:05. So yeah, 10 minutes. No, sorry, the break is until 10:20. So 20 minutes. We can make it a little bit shorter. So 10:15. Let's go back to 10:15. We will continue with specifically with GUIs for GUI toolkits for Python, and I hope that will answer some of the specific questions that you might have about how to deal with architectural patterns, event-driven programming, and multithreading. Well, not that much multithreading, but hopefully some questions related to that. All right. So I stop sharing. I stop recording. I should have stopped.